We are in Parshat Matot-Masei, and so before we, with this Parsha, it's interesting, it's a double Parsha. And what we do is, first we talk about Nedarim, vows, and oaths, then we're going to, the way the Parsha works, whether or not we'll get to any of these places, I don't know. But then the Parsha goes into the war against the Midianites, and the question is, why did we only go against to the war against the Midianites and not the Moabites? The Moabites, after all, were the ones who hired Balaam to curse the Jews. So why just go? They should go after both. Why only after going out to one? Then the one who leads them off into battle is Pinchas. Pinchas leads them all into the Jewish people into the battle of. To get revenge on the 24,000 people that were killed in the plague. And what happens is they bring back the women, the children, and the animals and the booty. So Moshe gets upset with them and says, why did you bring back the women? The women were the very reason for the plague because of the sexual debauchery that was going on. So the they go through the explanation, but it really is just shouldn't have done it. And so what happens is then they're told to split up the booty between the people who went to war and the Bnei Israel, different amounts for each one. Then after that, so the people who went to war took an accounting and realized that none of the soldiers had died. They recognized that as a miracle, so now they want to give an additional offering for that, which they were allowed to do. And then we are told about in the next parsha that those are the major topics of this parsha. And then in Masei we're told the 42 stops, which along the way that took place over 40 years. Most of the stops were in a few years of each other. They weren't constantly wandering. And why do we have to hear all 42 places? So the rabbis, this all takes that, I know we're not going to get here. The rabbis say that this two thoughts about that. One is that Hashem was showing the compassion he had upon us, that we weren't constantly on the move. We were staying in one place pretty standard because, again, the majority of the moves were in the first year and then in the last year. So for the most part, we're stationary for a couple of, for those middle years. We're moving a little bit. Not that much. And then the other explanation is that Rashi brings down that is when a father had a sick child and he was bringing him to all the doctors. So he tells them this is in this place, this is what happened, this place, this is what happened, so on and so forth. So also Hashem is reminding us by just saying the names of the places. He's telling us we went to here, from here, to here, from here, and we are supposed to remember what happened. Okay, that's number one. Then what it does is it goes into, after that, we hear of the boundaries of the land of Israel, the biblical boundaries, and that's important to know because there are mitzvot that only apply in Israel and not in outside of Israel, so I have to know where I am. So I have to know the exact boundaries that Hashem is just calling Eretz Israel. After that, we hear that the Levium get their cities of refuge, six in total, but altogether it's going to be 48. But six in total who are the major places that the Levium would live. And if somebody would accidentally murder somebody else, it had to be an accident, then they could run to that place. We hear those laws of the accidental murderer versus the murderer who wasn't accidental, who did out of hatred, and the goyer, the adam, the redeemer of the blood, the relative of the one who's killed. Finally, after all that is said and done, we hear the last piece, the piece where last week we were told about the daughters of Selofchad who went to Moshe and said, we also should have a land so that our father's name will not be erased. And God said to Moshe, they speak correctly. Well, now we hear the last part of that story. Namely, the tribe of Manasseh comes up and says, wait a second. Also presenting a halachic argument that if the ladies, you already gave the ladies the land, But if they marry somebody else, not part of our tribe, then the land, if, assuming that the husband survives the wife, the land will go to the husband, who's from a different tribe, and our land will be subtracted from. So they come with that claim, which again Moshe says, you have a good, you also are right. And this, and then we hear that the girl should marry within the tribe. What was your question?
I have two. Go ahead. One is, first one was, when it says Pinchas, you said Pinchas led the
war.
Led the battle against Midian, right?
Right.
For revenge on the amount of people who died in the plague.
For the people who died.
Right.
Right.
While the people who died in the plague chose idolatry. So right. Would there be a better reason to make war on Midian? Like doing this to us, what was the reason? Because it sounds like they were avenging the deaths of the people.
They're avenging the God tells them to go on avenge yourselves of these people who misled you.
Even though the people who died had chosen.
Of course, you have free will, Sean.
Right.
You're right. Yep. So, even so.
So then the second one was, like you said, the last part of Bubba had a, me and Bubba were on during Shabbos, we were wondering, one of the daughter's name was Noah.
Right. Not Noah, but Noah.
Noah.
Right.
So, but in English, Noah is Noah. So and this is the actual Noah. Hebrew Noah.
Right. Right. It's totally different spelling.
Right. Right. So
the names mean things. So what does Noah mean in Hebrew rather than Noah?
Noah means rest.
Yes.
Okay. Noah is Nun Aleph Hey. I'm not sure. Could be wander, could be a lot of different things. As far as I know, not. Okay. So now we're going to start with page 900. First, let's have an introduction to this. Our school does a nice job, so let's just see it. It says, the Torah introduces a chapter which, upon reflection, gives the person a right to do something that could heretofore could not be done, could only be done by God, namely to create a new halachic status by pronouncing the sort of vow or oath set in the passage. A person is given the power to invoke a neder, or a vow or an oath, thereby placing upon himself or others, or upon objects of his choice, a status equivalent to that of a commandment of the Torah. His neder is so strong that a person violating it can suffer the court-imposed penalty of lashes. It must be understood that there is no English equivalent for the word neder. For lack of anything closer, it's commonly translated as vow, a word that means a pledge to do something. A simple pledge, however, though a Jew must keep his word, is not the subject of this passage. The neder of the Torah's parlance is as follows. There are two categories of neder. One can prohibit to himself something that the Torah permits by saying, for example, the produce of such and such a country is forbidden to me for 30 days. Or one may, one may obligate himself to bring an optional offering or to perform an optional commandment, such as contribute to a particular charity or to consecrate a particular animal as an offering. So the neder under discussion in this passage is the first type of voluntary adopted prohibition, with the exception of a vow to perform a commandment such as B, which is when you're obligating yourself to bring an additional offering. One cannot use a neder to require oneself to perform an act. For example, if one were to declare, I make a neder to go to sleep on time, it is not binding under the terms of this passage. The second topic of the passage is shavua, an oath. By means of an oath, one might either prohibit oneself or require oneself to perform an act. Conceptually, there is a great difference between a neder and an oath. A neder changes the status of the subject. For example, if I have made an apple forbidden to myself, the apple has the status of forbidden food to me, and therefore I may not enjoy the apple. In contrast, an oath places an obligation only on the person. For example, if I had sworn to eat an apple, there is a new obligation upon me, but the halachic status of the apple itself is unchanged. Okay, understand? So we have a bit of a difference between the word neder and shavua. Yeah, you had a question?
Could, if you don't explain an oath or a vow to whoever is watching you, like your kid, like your kids, could that become a minhag? Like I don't have, I specifically make these sacrifices important, like sheep or whatever.
Right.
So then that, and you don't explain it to your child that it's just a vow for me, could that become a minhag? And it just
Anything could become what we call a minhag shtos,
right.
A minhag of stupidity. So if I'm not going to ask my father, my father in this case, why he's doing it, and the Torah doesn't say I have to do it, so I could, then the father died before ever explaining it to me. So it could be that I have a question about it, and so what is a minhag in the end? A minhag is a neder that I took upon myself. And ultimately, it can become a widespread thing if people don't understand why I'm doing it.
Right.
So it could turn into a minhag.
It seemed like
the minhag has the power of a neder, which is why it's so. That's why we don't like to break minhagim so easily.
Right. It seemed like when I was thinking this, it seemed like the not like the birth, but like because there was tradition always. But it seemed like the idea, this beginning of. If you don't explain it well, then that's what created.
It could be. It could be. Okay, it's possible. Here's the first pasuk. The first verse is, and this is a strange verse to begin the parsha with, namely, Vayedivir Moshe el Roshei HaMatot. So Moshe spoke to the heads of the tribes, the Bnei Israel of Bnei Israel, Lemor, saying, Zeh Adavah, this is the thing Asher Tzivah Hashem, that God commanded. What should the Torah have started with? What does every parsha start with? Famous words, Vayedivir Hashem el Moshe Lemor. Hashem spoke to Moshe saying, and then we'll go into it. So why does this parsha start with Moshe said to the heads of the tribe? So the Rashbam asks that, and he answers that he says, the fip shot, according to the simple understanding, Heichan matzinu shum parsha shmetchilat came. Where do we see where the parsha begins like this? Shlo nema, that it doesn't say vayedivir Hashem Moshe l'mor ishki yidor, because above it already said that he spoke speaking veich metchilat parsha kidiboro shel Moshe. So how can this parsha begin with the words only of Moshe? That it doesn't explain that it's coming from Hashem. Zet, and he says, Zet is Shuvati. This is my explanation. This is my answer to that. Rashbam, which is Rashi's grandson. He says, Lamala Ketiva, in the last Parsha, we ended off with Eile Ta'asul Hashem. These are things that you should do for Hashem in your appointed times. Levad min didrechem, besides your vows, vindivatechem, and your voluntary offerings. Sha'atem sarichem lahavi be'echav mishlosh v'galim, that you need to bring during one of the three pilgrimage festivals, because of the halacha of Baal Ta'acher, that you shouldn't be late with bringing your offerings. Or fulfilling your vows, like it says in the Masechta of Rosh Hashanah. So Halach Moshe v'diber. So Moshe went v'diber el Rosh HaMatot, and he spoke to the heads of the tribes. Shehem shoftim lahorot Israel, that they were the judges to teach Israel Hilchot Nedarim, to teach them the laws of these vows of the Nedarim. And he said to them, HaKadosh Baruch Hu commanded me, Shikravu nidrehem v'nidvotehem beregel, that you bring your vow and your voluntary offerings during the pilgrimage festival, pen ya'achru nidrehem, lest you go late with them, l'fichach ish ki yidroned l'Hashem korban. That's where it starts, when a man volunteers to make a vow to bring a korban, oh, he shavah shavu Allah not nafsho, or that he will make an oath to cause affliction to his soul. Okay, so that's why the Rashbam says it's the this forno also picks up this same situation. Oh no, I'm sorry. Yeah. He says, "There devash yitzivah Hashem. This is the matter that Hashem commanded. Kishamar b'sina b'har Sinai, when he said at Har Sinai, v'lo tisha'avu b'shmi l'sharkeh, that you should not make an oath, in my name, a false name, my oath, v'chilalta, and you will then profane it. Hayta kavon ha'isha nodir on nishba." That's referring, the kavanah, the intent was for the man who makes the oath or the vow or the oath. So that's when it says, "Lo yachel devaro," that you shouldn't be like, it shouldn't be, he shouldn't profane his word. Ki b'chal lo devaro, because when he profanes his word, when he does not fulfill his vow, b'chal lo Hashem, he causes the name of God to be profaned. Aval ha'isha, but the woman, she'eno bereshut atzma, she doesn't run her own life. She's married to a man, to her husband, or she's living in her father's house, and therefore until the age of 12, so she then is not under, she doesn't have the power to do anything. So lo tihiye mechalelet, she cannot profane her word, im yafir ha'mefir, if her husband can annul it or her father can annul it. We're going to get into that, okay? So that's where we're starting. That Hashem, that Moshe is speaking to Ben Israel, and he's telling them, this is what we have to do. Now what happens? It'll be easier in here for this point. Ish ki yudu neder, when a man makes a vow to Hashem, oh, he's a vow to all this, he's on the show. Or he makes a vow, an oath to establish a prohibition upon himself. Lo yechel devaro, he shouldn't profane his word. Kichol ha'yotzei mipiv yaaseh, like everything that comes out of his mouth, that's what he should do. So we have to, it's very important to remember that if you're going to make a vow, that's why we all say bli neder, right? Because we never know if we can really fulfill our vow. We think we can, we make a vow, but sometimes it breaks, sometimes we forget. So we don't want to get into this biblical prohibition. So we would then say bli neder, without making a vow, or whatever the case is going to be. Which is why, by the way, if I'm going to do something and I don't want it to be under the law of neder, so I would always say bli tanai. I'll tanai that it's not a neder. Not bli. I'm thinking on tonight, that's not a neder. I'm giving you a charity, but I'm not promising every single dime I'm going to give it to you. I don't want to get into neder. Okay, so then what happens? V'isha. Now you have a woman. Ki tidur neder l'Hashem, when she makes a vow to Hashem, v'asra isha b'beit aviyah, or she forbids herself something in her father's house, bin oreha, while she's a na'ara. Now a na'ara is a specific age. She's not a katana. Katana would be up until, when she's a minor. So that is until 12. When she's 12. From 12 to 12 and a half, she's a na'ara, a half a year. And then after that, she's a bogeret. She goes through three stages. Men only go through two stages. Bogeret. So men only go through two stages, katan and then gadol. That's all we have. There's no middle stage for us. Yeah.
What is na'ar then?
Na'ar is a young, it could be a young man, but that young man could be 55 years old. It could be a servant of somebody. When we say na'arav, I'll give an example. Yehoshua is called the na'ar of Moshe. Well, when he's being called a na'ar, he's 65. So a na'ar, it just means somebody's under, not the captain, if you will. So you can be a na'arav. But for a woman, it's a very specific term, from 12 to 12 and a half. So what happens is, if she makes a vow before then, in other words, before 12, the vow doesn't mean anything. It's like if a boy makes a vow before he's 13, it means absolutely nothing. You don't have the right to make vows. Why? Because we're under the tutelage. We're under somebody else's
sovereignty.
Great, thank you. Namely, our parents. So our parents have the right. They don't even have to say they nullify it because of something. That, so then the rabbis want to say, let's say the guy is 12, or it's for the girl 11, and she knows what she's saying. So then we may want her to keep it. But really, reality-wise, until the boy or the girl is bar or bat mitzvah, they're really not obligated. Like I said, the girl, she's a bat mitzvah 12. So from 12 to 12 and a half, her father can still annul it, depending on what the vow is. I'll be very specific. The vow has to be something that will hurt their relationship. It can't be that she says, I won't put on lipstick or something like that. Maybe that would be a problem, but because she's going for shidduchim. But it can't, it's dates. No, she's getting married. So it's, but it's something that doesn't apply. I won't skip rocks in the water. I won't skip rocks in the water. The father would say, it has nothing to do with him. And if she's going to a skip, you know, rock skipping contest, it means nothing. So you're going to have something out of your hand, though.
Can the parents make a vow for the child or no?
Can the parents make a vow for the no? They can't. You're forcing someone to do something that you can't do either. Okay, so not that I know of anyway. So then what happens? Shema Aviyah, the Torah says, the father heard her vow, Ed Nidra heard a vow. The Esra Asher Asher, or he heard the prohibition that she made upon his own, the Hecherish Laviyah. And the father was quiet. Vekam kol dinareh. As a result, all of her vows are established. Vekol yisar asher asher nafshat yikom. And any prohibition that she levied upon herself, in addition to what the Torah said, she is forbidden to do it. It becomes established. Why? Because the father said, no problem. You want to forbid yourself from eating the fruit of the country for 30 days? That's up to you. I'm not going to stop you. Matter of fact, you opened your mouth, I'm going to let you. Again, she's 12 to 12 and a half. So once the father does that, so then she's stuck. If she breaks the vow, she has to do repentance. Yeah.
What's the fruit of the country?
Whatever the fruit is. She says, I don't want to have blank fruit from blank country.
Oh.
Doesn't matter what the...
I
thought it was okay. No, it's not a specific fruit. She says specific fruit from a specific country. I'm just picking on that, where it doesn't affect him.
Yeah.
Doesn't affect him. Even if it does affect him, well, no, it has to affect him. It has to affect him where he can't do it, right? So let's say he's an importer, and he says, you don't want to eat it? Done. And so now she has to do that, okay? So now what happens? But if the father, as you said, annuls it, restrained her, Biyom Shama, on the day you heard it, so then all of her vows and all of her prohibitions that she made upon her soul, they don't stand. It's like she didn't say anything. Vashem Yislachla, and Hashem will forgive her. Wait a second. You just said her vow was worthless. So why is Hashem forgiving her? What does Hashem have to forgive her for? And then finally, Kiheni Aviyota, why does he forgive her? Because her father restrained her. Yeah?
A vow in vain.
A vow, okay, but why is it a vow in vain?
Because
she's dependent upon somebody else. That's the answer the Sephorno gives, exactly. Sephorno gives your answer. That you can't, that the reason she needs to be forgiven is because she still needed his permission. So she made a vow without checking with her father, or ultimately her husband. And now Rashi also says, and very interestingly, he says, why does Hashem forgive her? I just have to find it here. So the answer was right here. He says, what are these words speaking? Be'isha, with the woman that made a vow of Nazir. The husband heard her and annulled her vow, and she didn't know, she did not know. And she went against her vow, and she drank wine, or she became spiritually impure by dealing with dead people, that is the one who needs to be forgiven, even though it was already annulled. So Rashi says, it's coming from the Gemara. He said, it's coming from Gedushin. If a person whose vow was annulled needs to have forgiveness from Hashem, kol vechomer, all the more so one who didn't have their vow annulled and went against it needs to be forgiven. You understand? So here the woman really, she was not guilty. She didn't do anything wrong in reality, because her father or her husband annulled the vow, but she didn't know it. And so she thought that now the vow was still going on. And what she do? She takes a drink of wine. And by the way, it doesn't have to be she did it on purpose. She could have forgotten that she made a vow. Here's a glass of wine. She's drinking. Oh my God. Now I broke the vow. What am I going to do? So the husband tells her, don't worry, honey. I annulled it anyway. Of course, then she yells at him for why would you annul my vow? Okay. But still, Hashem forgives her. Why are you forgiving her? So it's because she didn't realize it, she still broke it. So even though that she really has nothing to be forgiven for, Hashem is forgiving her for making that vow. That's how Rashi is looking at it. Yeah.
When it says, like, for the 12 to 12 and a half year old, it has to be forgiven because he can't make a vow when you're dependent on somebody else.
Correct.
Why make the vow? If you know what you're saying, you know it's a vow, then you probably understand that you can't make a vow under somebody, unless when you're dependent on somebody.
Because you're hoping that the person won't annul it.
Oh, so you can still make a vow even under the person's, even being dependent on the person.
Oh yeah, of course. If the person, that's the first point here. If the father heard it and he said no problem, the vow stands. You're stuck. It's only when the father, again, I'm giving you a heads up, the husband is going to say no, then she has no choice. I mean, the vow didn't take effect. The interesting thing would be, and we're going to get to this too, is we'll get there. I think I can cover it, so let's go. You'll see it. Now, if she will be married to a man, which means Kedushin, she didn't yet do Eris, she didn't yet do Nisuyin. She's first stage married. Okay, yeah, remember, in marriage you have two stages, the Eris and Nisuyin. The Eris is when he says to the woman, this, you are betrothed to me with this ring, according to the laws of Moshe and Israel. Okay, so at that point they are quote unquote married, but they aren't living together. They didn't yet consummate. They now have 12 months to get all their stuff together, you know, to make sure the house is built, everything else, and then 12 months later, they're going to go under the chuppah and get married. Yeah.
Is 12 months in the Hebrew lunar calendar, is that the same as the year in solar calendar?
Yeah. Okay. Well, depends on the year, but yeah. Okay, but one more thing is you have a year. You have a year to get everything together. Now, the reason they would do that is because the guy had to get his, you know, he had to support her. So it's not, she has to get her dowry together, it's a business contract. In the end, it's all money. So we have to get everything done. So now, this guy engages, what we would call engaged for today, but it really is marriage. So now she makes a vow. If she was like that, Undarele, and there were vows, she had vows upon her. Oh, Mivtas Vatef, or the utterance on her lips, is her Asral Nashua, that forbid something again. So Shema Yishana, father, and the husband heard, Biyom Shamo, on the day that he heard, and he was quiet, becoming to Nidra again, the same rule as the father. Then all of her vows, Yesarel, she also knows Shah, Yakum, and all the prohibitions that she made upon her soul, they exist. They're there. Vim Biyom Bad, on the other hand, Vim Biyom Shamo, Isha, Yaniota. But if on the day that the husband heard, he said, not happening. I can't live with this. It's not good for both of us. Vehefir, and he nullifies and nidrash yaldah. Her vow that was upon her, via miftam sevateh, or the utterance of her lips, shirashra al nafshah, v'ashem yisokla. Again, Hashem will forgive her, even though the vow never took place. Now here's the other part. V'neda almana grusha. Let's say that she's a widow, or a divorcee. She is totally on her own. She's not falling back into her father's house because she got married, or she was even to the stage of kedushin, or she's a widow. Kol asher asra al nasha yekumala. Any prohibition that she puts on her soul, that stays. There's, you can't. She can't rely upon anybody nulling it. She's totally independent at that point. So once she's independent, then she's equal, as it were, to a man. If a man says, he shouldn't allow his word to become profaned. On the other hand, now we come to a fully married woman. Oh, by the way, the thing with the man, when she's engaged, the father and the future husband have to agree to annul it. If one of them says the vow is valid, then it's valid. So in the case of the Na'ara, again, 12 to 12 and a half, she gets married in that six-month part. So then both of them must annul it. If one of them doesn't, then the neder lasts. It goes into a being. So now we have the other side. She is the wife, full wife. In Beit Isha Nadara, if in the house of her husband, she made a vow. Or she prohibited something by an oath. Again, the same thing. Husband hears of it and he's quiet. He doesn't refrain. He doesn't restrain her. All her vows are there. And anything she said, she has fulfilled. On the other hand, if the husband heard it, and all that came out from her lips, her vows and the prohibitions, he doesn't establish isha hafiram. Her husband can annul them. Vashem yisachla. Again, Hashem will forgive her, following either one of the explanations we had. So here's something very, very interesting. Oh, I'll just finish it. Kol neida, kol shvot, isha la'anot nafesh, isha kemenu, isha yifarenu. Any vow or oath that is coming to afflict the soul, that's when the husband can annul it, can establish it, or can annul it. Again, it has to be something that's going to impact on their relationship. It can't be something that's not going to impact on the relationship. Otherwise, he has no power to annul. And now here's something else. If the husband was quiet for that day, in other words, the only hour is when he hears it, he has to annul it. But he didn't annul it. The Hakim called the rest. So all of her vows were established. Oh, I call us the or all the prohibitions that she had. Hakim otam. Because he was quiet, so this it was established. Vimhafir yafir otam achare shamo. Let's say he annulled it after that. Okay, he had a time period. Let's say till 8 o'clock that night. 8 o'clock, he does, and he was saying, I'm living with this, no problem. So it automatically goes into effect. Now what he does, he doesn't like his wife so much. So what he does is he nullifies it, or he tells her, don't worry, honey, I nullified it. So if she nullified it, it doesn't come into effect. So now she can break it, right? So what happens is, v'naset avona, he carries her sin. In other words, when she breaks it, it's his problem. He has to fulfill it. And that's what he says, Eilechu kimashut tzivah Hashem al Hashem. These are the statutes that Moshe, that Hashem committed to Moshe, whether it's between a man and his wife, or between a father and his daughter, while she's a na'ara in her father's house. Yeah, what was your question?
So, the wife makes a vow, like a Nazarite vow, then later accidentally has some grape, has some wine or whatever, right. And it said, oh wait, I made a vow, and then you had the husband before, didn't say anything, but heard her make the vow, annulled the vow, didn't tell her, but then told her then, and said it was okay.
Right.
This is somehow a husband who didn't annul the vow and is just messing with her.
Right, this is a husband who didn't, he established the vow, and then he tells her when, because he doesn't like her, so he says, guess what, I annulled the vow, so then she goes and she breaks it. So what we're learning is that he takes her place for all the punishments. And what we're learning from that is that one who causes another to sin, he or she, well, I'm using he because I'm just it's language, but it's they take the place of the person who sinned. So if I'm causing you to sin, if I'm the machte, in other words, I tell you something is permissible when it's really forbidden. So it's my fault. That's why when... that's why it's when you go to a rabbi, it's very hard to find somebody who's going to tell you something that we know is forbidden is permitted. Driving on Shabbos. Okay? So normally the rabbi is going to tell you can't. If it's, I'm not talking about in health situations. I'm talking about in regular situation. They'll tell you, no, you can't go. So some rabbis who want to argue, and I'm picking on the other movements for this, of course, that, yeah, you can drive. Well, they are the machte. They are the ones who are causing these people to sin because these people may not have driven to Shul. They may drive somewhere else. I'm not going to argue that. But they certainly would not have said, oh, I can drive to Shul and back and still be within the confines of the law. If the rabbi would just said, no, I'm sorry, we can't allow that. Yeah.
So that be idea of putting someone
above
in front of a blind person?
Absolutely.
Okay.
Yeah. Okay, so now we come to the second, so what I was talking about, the war. So it says, Vayedaber Hashem Moshe Lemor. We're on chapter 31, verses 1 through 2. It says, Nekom Nekom B'nei Yisrael, so take vengeance for B'nei Yisrael, Me'et Amidyanim, from the Midyanim, Acha Teosef, Elamechan. After that, Moshe Rabbeinu. Well, he didn't say about Rabbeinu. After that, Moshe, you will die. Okay? So Moshe is told, get the people to fight the Midianim, get revenge on them, and after that, Tzadik, it's time to come home. You're going to die. Okay? Why? So what happens? If you were Moshe Rabbeinu, what would you do? Or if you were told, yeah?
Is it get revenge on them or deal with justice?
Avenge, what are you going to call that? Take vengeance, says. But yeah, ultimately, well, what's the justice, actually? I'll ask you, what's the justice there? Do you know who did it? Now, when I say get justice, I want to get the guy who did the deed. But it was the women who did the deed. It's the women who enticed the men who had sexual debauchery with them and caused them, well, they didn't cause, they asked them, if you want to have me, you have to bow down to my idol. So they got them involved. So really, the men were the dogs about this. So who are you going to blame? The kings? The king sent their daughters into to attempt the Jewish men. Okay, fine. But is that that's not a killable offense? Really, it's not. So when you're saying justice, I have a problem with saying that was just. Because Hashem, well, Hashem said, take vengeance on them because they're the ones who caused the people. So here, you have right here, and look on page 903. He gives an explanation for this. He says, now at hand was the retribution that had been promised against the Midianites because of their responsibility for the Jewish sins of immorality and idolatry that resulted in the death of 24,000 Jews in the plague. The Moabites, and this is a question that we're asking, however, were spared. Why? So all the tribes, including Levi, were equally represented in the fighting force, and they were accompanied by Pinchas. Oh, he's not answering the question. Who, in a sense, began this task by slaying Zimri and Cosby, and thereby ending the plague that the Midianites had brought upon the Jewish people. His presence with the fighters deflected the inevitable criticism that Israel too was at fault for not having resisted the blandishments of the Midianite women For Pinchas displayed courageous loyalty to Hashem and was thus a source of merit for his brethren. It is noteworthy that Hashem did not command that Pinchas join the army. Perhaps it would have been an implied criticism of Moshe, who had not acted against Zimri, but Moshe understood the nation needed the merit of Pinchas and that he was essential to the success of the undertaking. So take vengeance. God spoke of avenging the harm that had been done to Israel, but the next verse, when Moshe conveyed the commandment to the Jews, he spoke only of avenging the slight to Hashem's honor, for he said, had we been idolaters, they would not hate us or persecute us. Thus, the vengeance is for Hashem. Rashi comments that one who wrongs Israel is regarded as one who wronged Hashem. So that's where they're getting it from. That's the vengeance. That you wronged Hashem by tempting the people, knowing that they would be weak. It's an interesting defense of the people, but nonetheless, that's what we're, anybody who fights against us is not fighting against us per se, the Rashi explaining, but really fighting against God. Yeah.
And after this, we took
say it again.
After this battle, we took back all their riches and women and goats and all the riches and stuff, right? Didn't we also do that with Amalek?
No. Amalek we wiped out totally.
Except the king.
No. You're talking about Shaul.
Oh.
That'll be later on. Shaul will take the king because he wanted to. He also took the animals, but he wanted to show that we can capture and so on and so forth. Shmuel yells at him for that, and he loses his kingdom based upon that. But in the case, in our thing of Amalek, there was no spoils of war. In other words, when Joshua was leading off, there were no spoils. It was wiped out.
So, but that seems familiar. They were commanded to wipe them out, but they brought back stuff.
Well, they weren't commanded. They said get avenge them. Wasn't commanded to wipe them out. Because he brought back the we're going to hear, but they brought back the women. Who were the some of the women who were known to be the sinners, who were the people who were causing to be sin? He's going to say it straight out. So he's, we'll see. Vayedibar Moshe el ha'am le'mor. So Moshe said to the nation, saying, "Hey, chalzu etchem, me'idchem an l'shun l'sava." So arm yourselves for the legion that. They may be against Midian. You'll be against Midian. Take Nikmat Hashem Midian to take avenge to avenge God Midian. El flamata lechomaton Yisrael. 1,000 from each tribe of Israel to Shulu Savai shall send to the army via Masru. Now, by the way, I don't want to skip over this. Rashi explains that Moshe's response is okay. Let's get the army together. Afal P says even though. That he knew that his death was dependent upon this action. In other words, you do it, you're dead. He did it happily. He didn't wait. Hashem told him, "You, this war is over. You're dead. You're gonna come back. You're coming home." Moshe, everybody else who would hear, "I'm gonna die. I have time. Let's push this off a little. I'll get to it sooner or later." Yeah, but Moshe didn't.
I don't know if it was Shalom.
Joshua.
Was it Joshua who prolonged the taking
right.
over of Canaan?
Right. So Joshua prolonged it and didn't help. But so you would think that Joshua would have learned from Moshe. But it's but this is a praise of Moshe that he didn't hesitate. Okay, so Vayimashu me'alfa Israel, so he gave over they were delivered 1,000 of Israel, Elf Mateh, Shemasad, Elef, Chalusi, Savah, 12,000, fine. Vishlach, Otam Moshe, Elef, Mateh, Savah, Otam, Yepinchos, Ben Elazar, Quen Savah. So he sends the 12,000 men with Pinchas to the army, Uklea Kodesh, Chatzachor, Trubiado, and the clay kodesh, the vessels, the holy vessels, and what are we talking about there? So it says that was the Aron, and what happened was, and the tzitz. So what happened was, Bilam was with them. He came back to collect his money. Umafriach malchim idyam kshafim. So they were floating because due to witchcraft. And he was floating with them. Her'al lehem et ha'sitz. So Pinchas showed them the sitz that Hashem's name is engraved on, and they, as a result, they fell. So everybody's floating around here. You have magic carpets. Everybody's floating around. So they see that sitz with Hashem's name. The witchcraft is destroyed, and now they all fall, and they fall from the sky, as it were. And that's why it says, Al Chaleim, the Malchimidian, Shinoflam Al Chaleim, they fell on their swords from the sky. Also, Bilam, he also fell. So it's interesting that we, for all those who think that we weren't able to fly, they could levitate or whatever it was. Okay. According to the Midrash. So and then Vayishbu al Midian, okay, they went against, made war on Midian, Kashir Sivash and Moshe, just as Hashem commanded, Vyargu Kol Zachar, and they killed all of the males. Malchim Midian Hargu Achaleim, again the kings they had killed by the swords. And then they give the names at every Rekem, Sor, Chor, Reva, Chamesh, Malchim Midian. All five of them. So here's something interesting too. Sor is the third number, right? Every Rekem Sor. Remember, Kazbi Bat Sor. Kazbi was the one who was killed with Zimri. Well, sorry?
She was a princess.
Of Midian, right. So here, he was originally first, but because he left his daughter go to do the sexual immorality, he's already pushed to third. He gets lost in the shuffle as well. Okay, yeah.
So did Evi not send his daughters?
I am not sure about that. But Cosby is the one. Cosby but so got to be with. She was the famous one.
Okay.
Right. So Vayishbu b'nei Yisrael, and here we go. Vayishbu b'nei Yisrael in the Shem Midian, v'yatapam, v'yabehemtam, v'yabehem. So the Jews captured the women of the Midianites, the children, the animals, all the possessions. They took them, they had Rahem, Shotam, they burned the cities. They called Shalat, took all the booty, fine. They have you, El Moshe, El Elazar, Kohen. They brought them all to Moshe and Elazar, the Kohen, and to the whole congregation of Ben Israel, and all this, and what happened? The Eitz of Moshe, the Elazar, Kohen, Kunzi, and Eda, the Kratam, the Eitz of Moshe. Now here's the part you ask. And Moshe was angry. Everybody. Why? Moshe said to them, you kept alive all of the females? You live in Israel, but about Bilam. They themselves were the ones who caused the problem by the word of Bilam. Bilam gave them this advice. They're the ones who caused the problem. And Limsar Ma'al Ba'ashem al Devar Po'or, to cause this the betrayal against Hashem. And thus caused the whole plague amongst the congregation of Israel. So he says, okay, done. I'm not going to get, I didn't, I should have told you, kill everybody. I didn't. Therefore, kill every male among the young children. And any woman who knows or was, would have been of age to know a man, and that was sexually, so kill her too. Okay, that's how he's stopping everything. He's saying stop them all. But call it up, and every woman who's under that age, so they can live. V'yatem, and you people who killed, you have to stay outside the camp for a little while. Shivat yamim, for 7 days. Call it reg nefesh. So then anybody who killed them will have to, or touch the metal, touch the nerves, which would be stuck to their bodies. So now you're becoming impure. So you have to be sprinkled on the third and the seventh day. And then on all your clothes, you have to take care of too. We'll have to stop there. But here's also where you get the next paragraph is where we get the laws of kashrut, of how to kasher things. From verse 21 to 25, that's where we get the laws of how to kasher, and that's why something that went through fire, like a spit has to be made red hot. If it's on the flame, then it has to be boiled out. Or if it's something else, whatever. Yeah.
I have two questions. What did they do with the children that were left?
they would live amongst us. Oh. They would be converted because they were too young to know what they were.
Okay. And they bury the rest of the people, or they just throw them in a the pile?
Oh,
do you bury the people?
Some we buried them. It would have, I'm not sure if they would have had, you know, separate grave sites. But I don't think they. We don't view human bodies as just something to throw away. So, you know, it's a holiness to them. It's God's creation. So, you know, we're not going to throw them to a mass grave, I don't think. But we probably would have buried them. Yeah. Okay.